Stuka Joe here, and we're about to begin the 1805 to 1814 campaign game in Napoleon Against Europe. We have here the units set up. We can see that Napoleon's Grande Armée, the main French force, is stationed at Lille, about to invade Great Britain when the Battle of Trafalgar mauled the French and Spanish Allied fleet, so the invasion of Great Britain is cancelled. And the Third Coalition is at war with Napoleon, and it consists of Great Britain, Austria, and Russia. At the beginning of the game, the Austrian forces are concentrated in southern Germany. The main Austrian army is commanded by Mack, which is a very ineffective leader. There's a force that is equal in size to Mack's army, commanded by Archduke Charles, and a small force under Archduke John. Special scenario rules force the coalition to have to lay siege to the fortress of Ulm and the citadel of Mantua before the coalition does anything else in terms of actions and activations. That gives the French a chance to force march Napoleon's army and defeat the Austrians before their Russian allies can join with them. Napoleon's Grande Armée is a truly formidable force. First, it is commanded by the best general in the game, Napoleon. Napoleon has a tactical rating of 3 on offense and 3 on defense, and he is activated by any card with at least 1 activation point. In addition, he can command up to 9 steps of units, and if he's commanding an army, that is doubled up to 18. Let's take a look at the composition of the Grande Armée. The Grande Armée has 3 able leaders in Davout, Murat, who is also a cavalry general and provides a bonus for cavalry superiority, and also Marshal Soult. There are 4 elite corps, and the elite status is signified by that yellow star beside the number in the middle. There's 2 regular corps, and this is a reduced Imperial Guard corps. In addition, there's a reserve cavalry corps and 2 mobile supply units. Massena's Army of Italy, however, is the French formation which is closest to the Austrians. Let's take a look at its composition. This army is not big at all. It only has 1 subordinate leader in Lannes, and it has 1 full-strength regular corps, 1 half-strength regular corps, and an allied Italian corps, as well as a mobile supply unit. The Austrian Army of Germany under Mack starts here at Salzburg. Let's take a look at its composition. It is composed of 3 regular infantry corps, 1 half-strength cavalry corps. The subordinate leader is Ferdinand. He only adds 1 in attack, so he's not very impressive, and 1 mobile supply unit. Archduke Charles is a much more able leader when compared to Mack. He has a 1 in attack and 2 on defense. He is commanding 4 regular Austrian infantry corps and a mobile supply unit. Archduke John's force is just a meager 1 regular infantry corps. Each turn in the game is composed of 4 phases: the interphase, the activation phase, conquest and surrenders phase, and victory phase. The game starts in the 1805 turn in the second round of the activation phase. The activation phase can consist of 6 or 7 rounds per turn. Now, we will be showing you in this particular video the 1805 turn, starting here and ending here. And we will go into some detail as to the processes and the mechanics that we encounter. The second video of this game will start with the 1806 turn here in the interphase. And when we get to the activation phase, we will show the movements and combat actions of the forces here in more of a summarized form. So that way we can advance more quickly through the series of videos of this playthrough. Before we begin the activation phase, let's take a look at what the key objectives in this game are in terms of zones, and also the starting hands for each of the sides. This is a custom card assignment table. The original assignment table is like a checklist. I find this a little bit more practical. At the beginning of the game, each of the sides receive seven cards. But from the next turn onwards, depending on the objectives listed in the card assignment table, each side receives one card. For instance, the French will receive their permanent card if they control Paris. And at the beginning of the game, they control Paris and these three zones in France. In addition, they control Mantua, and Spain is an ally, so they control Madrid. So if things stay as they are for the next turn, the French will receive six cards, and you can receive each turn a minimum of six and a maximum of 10. When we look at the coalition, we see here, for example, that the British have their permanent card secured if they maintain control of London. And because Austria is in the war, if they keep control of Vienna, they will have the Austrian permanent card. Moscow, control of Moscow, gives the coalition the Russian permanent card. But they also start in control of Prague, because it's that's an Austrian key zone. And these key zones in Russia, St. Petersburg and Odessa and Kiev, both count for one card. In addition, the coalition has Gibraltar and Malta, the two Sicilies, which is Sardinia and Sicily, and they control Lisbon because Portugal is an ally of the coalition. So if things stand as they are, for the next turn, the coalition will receive nine cards. Therefore, it is important, as stated before, for the French to knock out Austria out of the war. By knocking Austria out of the war, the coalition would lose the cards for Vienna and Prague, and also the French would gain one additional card for knocking a major power out of the war. But for now, this is the situation on the card assignment table. This is the reserves display. The original game doesn't bring one. This is a custom one I made. And by the way, this reserve display and the card assignment table that you just saw is available for download on the file section of Board Game Geek. This is a place where players place the units and leaders which are available to enter the game. There are other units not shown here that have a small red E or a V, and they enter the game by special rule or as a result of an event. And we're seeing here the reserve section for France, Great Britain, Russia, Austria, Prussia, Spain, and Turkey. A word about the dice. The game brings two white dice, but for ease of explanation, whenever you see that we roll a blue die, that is the French die roll, and a red die, the coalition die roll. Let's talk about the cards. This is a card-driven game, and at the beginning of the game, each side receives seven cards. They receive their permanent cards, plus whatever cards needed to fill the hand up to seven. The French have a permanent card for France, and as long as they control Paris, they will receive it. So the French would receive the permanent card plus six additional cards. Among the seven cards that the coalition player receives at the beginning of the game, three are what is called permanent cards. And these permanent cards can be played during a turn for their activation value or their event. And they will always return to the coalition player's hand during the next turn as long as their respective capital is still under friendly control. In the case of Britain, it is London. And in the case of Russia, Moscow. In the case of Austria, Vienna. Now note that the events for the Russian and Austrian permanent cards have a silver star. This means that if the card is played for the event takes place. The card will return if the capital is still under friendly control, but that particular event cannot take place again in the game. It only takes place once per game. And that is not the case with the British permanent card. The event can take place more than once during the game. We have to fill up the coalition's hand up to seven, so we take four cards from the draw pile. Okay, we've drawn the cards for both sides. Let's take a look at the French hand. Here we see we have the permanent French card, the Genius of Napoleon, a three-point activation card, or it can be used for its event, and it can be used turn after turn after turn. It practically cancels enemy major campaign card, or it allows a force by Napoleon to force march without any attrition at the end of the force march. Other notable cards here are this card. FW means a foreign war. Play of this card for the event will cause a foreign war in which
Russia will have to dedicate a full corps, two steps, to this foreign war. Basically, what that means is that those two steps will be out of this war as long as the foreign war is in effect. And you see here the yellow star means that any event that is played and has a yellow star causes the card to be permanently removed from the game. We have another card here, Fouché, which is a three-point activation value card, and it has the effect of immediately discarding an enemy card from its hand. We have here the Cavalry of the Guard, which brings a special cavalry unit to the French, and we have here Tirailleurs, which is a combat card, and it reduces the enemy's combat value by one. Finally, we have this very important card, Marie Wałęsa. This card creates Poland as a protectorate. If played for its event, it raises the escalade level by two, and it provides the French with one victory point. Here's the initial coalition hand. Here are the three permanent cards for the major powers that comprise the coalition. This is the permanent British card, Admiralty, a three-point activation card, but the event, as the event for the French permanent card, can be played turn after turn. And this one permits the activation of all British and minor allied fleets with naval transports and allows one amphibious assault. Now, when you look at the events for the Holy Empire and Holy Russia, they have a silver star. That means that we can play this card for the event, but the card will not be discarded permanently, but the event can only take place once in the whole game. And you have here that this card allows the deployment of three corps from the reserve, and or six resources in the next budget, or military reform after Austria is conquered for the first time. So it can be played in the activation phase or during the budget phase, which is a subphase of the interphase. The Holy Russian card, if played for its event, can be played if at least 10 enemy combat steps are in Russia, and we deploy the units that are stated there. And it also permits the play of the card Scorched Earth. So it can be played during the diplomacy phase, which is in the interphase, or during the activation phase. There's also this combat card, which gives a bonus of mine a plus one in combat. The National Pride card, which rallies immediately a demoralized force of one of the major powers for the coalition. The major campaign card, a very powerful card. This allows three forces to be activated for movement, and we resolve combat after they have all moved. In regular terms, in this game, you move one force and resolve all combat caused by that force before you move the second force. But here you can move three forces and you can coordinate them so that they attack another force in a coordinated way. And we have here Harem, and this card immediately ends a foreign war involving Russia. During the game, the first time we encounter any specific mechanic, I will be showing you how it is resolved in its corresponding table. So if we undergo a siege, I will explain how it is resolved here in the siege table with any modifiers that may apply. The same thing with the battle table and any other table that is required to resolve a situation. Now, the second time we encounter the same mechanic, I will not be showing the table. I will just be explaining what the result is and what is its effect on the units on the map. At the beginning of the game, the escalade level starts at zero. If it ever reaches 15, we add the punishments deck to the epic deck, which is the one we would begin the game with. The victory point level is at 5. If it ever goes down to zero, the coalition win an automatic victory. But if it ever goes up to 20, France wins an automatic victory. The game starts in the year 1805, and we begin with the French second round. It is important to note that always rounds 1 through 4 are clear weather rounds. Round 5 is a bad weather round where all movement allowances are reduced by 1. Round 6 is always winter, which
allows also or forces all units to lose one movement factor in addition to severe attrition penalties. And there may be, in some instances, a seventh round. Most of the time, a turn will end with the sixth round, but there's a card that allows for an additional seventh winter round. So we begin the game with round number two for the French. Situation is interesting at the beginning. Napoleon can force march right now and attack John, but that would liberate the Austrians from having to besiege these two fortresses. So we want them to do that because they become more vulnerable. They spread out. So ideally, it is a good idea to move Marmont, pick up this French corps, move in a southerly direction, and end up here in Bavaria, which is an ally of France. And then in the second French activation, fall upon the Austrians. Now, Marmont's force to be activated, we need two activation points because that's his activation rating. When we look at our cards here, we have a bunch of three cards. We have only one activation two card, but if we play it for the event, for the activation, we have to put in the discard pile. And I really like this French cavalry special unit. So I may have to play one of these 3-point cards to move Marmont. And so what we're going to do is play this Persia card for its activation value. And it is 3. Because we played it for the activation value, it is discarded, but it will return later to the game. So we place it in the discard pile. So we activate Marmont, and Marmont has an activation value of 2, signified by that red 2 there. So we activate his force, which consists of a reduced French elite corps and a reduced Dutch corps. Now look at the Dutch corps. The rightmost number is 3. That means it moves 3 movement factors. So if we move this stack together, it will move at the rate of the slowest unit, 3 movement factors. So Marmont will move his force to Hanover. That would be 1 movement factor. Pick up this elite French unit to Wesel, to Berg, and that would be 3 movement points there. But we're going to force march Marmont an additional movement factor here to Baden, which is allied to France. That would be 4. And we're going to end here with 5 movement points together with the Bavarian unit at Würzburg. So that means we're going to force march 2 additional movement points. So Marmont moves to Hanover, picking up the elite French corps and continuing its move into Wesel, moving 1 additional zone to the south, then into Baden, and finally into Bavaria, specifically at Würzburg, where it ends its move and joins with the reduced Bavarian corps. Now we have to roll for the attrition effect of this force march. Now we consult the attrition table. Note that the Bavarian unit didn't move at all. Marmont's force ended its turn in the same space as the Bavarian unit, so this unit does not suffer any effect for the attrition. Okay, we see that the force has a total of 1, 2, 3, 4 combat factors. So we use the 4-5 combat factor or step column. The modifiers are +1 per movement point required. This force marched 2 movement factors because its movement rate was that of the slowest unit, the Dutch Corps. So that is a +2. And the force is composed of at least 50% of French steps. It is actually a force of 4 steps, and it has 3 French steps. So that is a -1. But downside is that the first step loss must be taken by a French unit. So we have a total of +1 on the 4-5 step column. So we roll 1 die. The result is a 5 modified to a 6, and 1 step is lost.
So what we will do is we will reduce the elite 7th Corps by flipping it to its reduced side.
And we return the units and place them back in Würzburg. And that's the end of Marmont's activation. The French have one activation point left. They have two options. They can save that activation point and use it in a further phase or round, I should say, of this turn, or they can activate Napoleon. Napoleon has an activation rating of 1, that red 1 there, and he's the only leader in the board now that has that activation rating. So the French can activate the Grande Armée, and they will do so. Now, Napoleon doesn't want to leave the coast of France here, northern France, vulnerable to British invasion. So Napoleon will leave one regular strength corps with a leader at Lille. So Napoleon will leave Marshal Soult with a regular infantry corps at Lille, and the Grand Army will not force march, but will move its full movement allowance of 4 to Soissons, here to Metz, and spending the last 2 movement factors to end its move here in Strasbourg. That ends the French second round, and now we go to the coalition's second round. As we stated before, the coalition has to comply with a special rule of attacking by siege Ulm and Mantua before they can do anything else. And the problem for the coalition is that their forces here, to be activated, need at least 2 activation points per force or per army. So that means that to activate John and Charles in the same round, you have to spend 4 activation points. And at this time, they have saved no activation points, and there are no 4 activation point cards. But luckily for the coalition, they have this major campaign card with which they can activate 3 forces for movement before the resolution of combat. So they will play this card to activate John's force to move into the zone surrounding Ulm and lay siege to Ulm, as well as Charles' force to do the same on Mantua and not move the Army of Germany, but Bellegarde's force march 1 zone and end its move here in Munich to serve as a barrier to protect Max's army. So John's force moves from Tyrol into Ulm. Charles moves from Venice into the swampy area surrounding Mantua. John has 2 movement points left, and he will use both movement points to make siege attacks against Ulm, so he can make 2 siege attacks. Charles has a movement allowance of 3. He spent 2 to enter the swampy area here, so he has 1 movement point left to lay siege on Mantua. And now we move Bellegarde's force. And we move Bellegarde's force. He's going to move 4 movement factors. That is a force march of 1. 1 here. A second movement factor into Vienna. A third into this area surrounding Salzburg. And a fourth movement factor to enter the zone surrounding Munich. And Munich is allied to the French. The Austrians will not spend another movement factor to convert the area to Austrian control in order to pass supplies through that area, so that zone. It's not necessary because John can trace supply into Innsbruck here, which is a fortress in national territory. Now we resolve attrition for Bellegarde. He moved an additional movement point. That is a +1. So there is a +1 die roll modifier on the attrition table. He rolled a 4, modified to a 5, no losses for the Austrian force. Now we resolve the siege attacks for John and Charles. John is laying siege on Ulm. We use the differential of tactical values of the generals. The only general is John. He has a 1 in attack, so that's a +1. There is no other modifier that applies. Note that duration of the siege, it is a +1 per siege marker, but the siege marker, since this is the initial siege attack,
is a plus zero. So it is a plus one, and we roll 1d6. 3 plus 1 is a 4, stable. That means that there's no effect and the siege continues. Now, John announces that he will spend his last movement factor, his third movement factor, to execute an additional siege attack. So now we flip the siege marker to its plus one side. And now the total die roll modifier is plus two. So we roll 1d6, 1 modified to a 3, still stable. So John fails to take Ulm by siege. And John ends his activation, but now the siege modifier for the next attack by John's force will be plus two. Now we solve Charles' siege attack on the citadel of Mantua. The modifiers are here plus one for Charles' attack rating, but minus two because Mantua, you see it's a bigger symbol, is a citadel. And citadels have minus two in attrition resolution. This is a total of minus one. So we roll 1d6, 3 modified to a 2, stable. And that is the end of Charles's activation. We flip the siege marker to its plus one side. So if Charles maintains the siege next time he attacks, he'll get a plus one for duration of the siege. Now that ends the coalition's second round. And the major campaign card doesn't have a yellow star, so it goes to the discard pile and it may return to the game later. Now we move along to the French third round and we still have clear weather. John failed to take the fortress of Ulm. That means that Napoleon can now attack John and John cannot take refuge in the fortress. And Napoleon may practically overrun John's force and even may be able to attack Bellegarde in this same activation. The French still have 6 cards left, and we can use cards in this game for activation points, but we can also conduct one round in which we don't use any card and we receive 1 activation point. And that is enough, actually, to activate Napoleon, and that's what we're gonna do. It saves us cards, and remember that in this game, we use cards during activation, but also during other phases of the game, like the diplomatic phase and the budget phase. So we will conduct a 1 activation point round, and we'll activate Napoleon's Grande Armée. Napoleon's Grande Armée has 4 movement points. We will not force march. We wanna avoid any losses by force marching at this time. He will spend the first movement point to move into Baden. We won't pick up the Württemberg Allied reduced corps because that would slow the whole Grande Armée down to 3 movement points. The second movement point will be to enter the area surrounding Ulm. And now we have a battle between the Grande Armée and John's force. As we can see here, this is not a fair battle. We have the French, and we totaled the leftmost number, which is the number of combat factors, and at the same time, loss steps. The French have 9, 11, 13, and the Austrians have 2. 13 between 2 is 6-1, and in this game, any odds of 5-1 or greater are an automatic victory for the most numerous side. So here, the Austrians are eliminated. So we place the eliminated corps in the reserve together with the general, John. So Napoleon's army just eliminated the Austrians besieging Ulm, so we remove the siege marker, and he has 2 movement points left. He uses his third movement point to move into the area surrounding Munich and attack Bellegarde. Bellegarde's force is very similar to that of John. 1 Austrian corps, but he also has a supply unit. So if Bellegarde stands and fight, he's going to be overrun too. So Mack will attempt to countermarch to join Bellegarde and make a stance in Munich. Let's take a look at the countermarch mechanic. We roll 1d6 and we need 5 or more, and the modifiers are the tactical value in attack or defense, depending on the situation. This is a countermarch in defense, but Mack has a 0 in both areas. And there is, if the general commanding an army is in the battle zone, he may substitute his value. Well, the general in the battle zone is not commanding an army, so that doesn't apply, and this does not apply. So basically, Mac has to roll 5 or 6 without any modifier. So we roll 1d6. The roll is a 1, so Mac does not come to the rescue of Bellegarde and stays put. And because it was an unsuccessful countermarch, Mac doesn't have to roll for an attrition test. So as a result of Mac's failure to countermarch and join Bellegarde, now Napoleon overruns Bellegarde. As we saw before, the Grande Armée has 13 combat factors, Bellegarde 2, that's 6 to 1, anything over 5 to 1 is an overrun, so Bellegarde's force is eliminated. So Bellegarde joins John in the Austrian reserve, and we place the eliminated unit and mobile supply depot there too. Napoleon's Grande Armée has one movement point left. He can stay put there. He doesn't have to convert this space to French control because it is already an ally of France. And remember, the Austrians didn't convert it to Austrian control. So he can trace supply through that space. And what the Grande Armée will do is it will spend its last movement point to move into the area around Salzburg and attack Mac's army. Okay, here we have the forces aligned for battle. We have to determine if this is a major or a minor battle. A major battle is one where the total of combat factors on both sides is 22 or more, and the smallest force has at least 10 combat factors. Here, it is not because the Austrians have 9 combat factors. The French have an obvious advantage in terms of modifiers. We add a +3 for Napoleon's offensive tactical rating. We can use the tactical rating of one subordinate. We're going to use that of Davout, which has also 2. So that's +5 for now. Then there's a thing called cavalry superiority. And we count the steps of cavalry plus any cavalry leader. We have that the French have 2 steps of cavalry plus Murat, who is a cavalry leader. So that is a total of 3 for cavalry superiority purposes. The Austrians have only 1 step. So that's another +1, and now we're at +6. And in addition, we can designate as the French a lead unit, and if the lead unit is an elite unit, that will add another +1. So we will designate the first corps as the lead unit. The downside is that the first loss step must be taken by that lead unit. On the Austrian side, we take a look at Mac, and he has a 0 on defense, so he doesn't add anything, but we can add the defensive rating of a subordinate, and unluckily for Austria, Ferdinand also has a 0 on defense. There are no elite units for the Austrians, so the Austrians get no modifier at all. Here we have the battle table. We roll on the middle column, which is the one for a minor battle. This is a column for a skirmish, and this is the one that we use for a major battle. Note also that for the attacker, there is a die roll modifier in the event that we have any of these odds present. Here we have 1 to 1, so it is 0. So that does not affect our attack here. So we roll for the French 2d6 +7. The roll is a 6 modified to a 13. And the Austrians suffer 3 step losses. Now we roll 2d6 for the Austrians with no modification. And the Austrians also roll a 6, and they cause 1 step loss on the French army. The French have to suffer 1 step loss, and it has to come from the unit that was leading the attack, the first corps. So we flip this unit to its reduced side. And now we will take 4 steps from the defending force. We will eliminate the first corps, satisfying 2 steps, and reduced the second and third Austrian corps. Next, because a subordinate provided a combat bonus, in this case Davout, we roll 1d6 to see if he's a casualty, and he only becomes one if he rolls a 6. So we roll 1d6. The roll is a 2, so Davout is fine.
Now we check to see if the Austrian army is demoralized, and that's where this number here in the middle, this red 3, comes into play. This is the morale value of each unit. In the Austrian army, all units have a morale of 3, so the army has a morale of 3. We start by taking the morale value of the Austrian army, which is 3, and we add the tactical value of the general commanding the force. The problem is Mack has 0 on defense, so he contributes nothing. Then we add the differential in losses with the winner. The French lost one step, the Austrians 4, so there's a minus 3. So the base morale of 3 minus 3 is 0, and we add any combat card. There are no combat cards, so the modified morale value is 0. And the defeated force will become demoralized if the die roll is higher than 0. So any result is going to be higher than 0. So the Austrian army is demoralized. We place this grim black flag to signify that the army is demoralized. And the misfortunes for the Austrians don't end here. Now, the French, as victors, have the right to effect a cavalry pursuit. And now we're going to resolve that. What we do here is we roll 1d6, and any score above 6 is the number of additional losses we'll take from the losing side. And we add to our die roll the tactical value of the general commanding the force. So we get a plus 3 for Napoleon's tactical value, plus 1 for each step of reserve cavalry. That's 2 more steps, so that's a plus 5, and a plus 1 for each cavalry general. We have Murat, so that is a total of plus 6. Well, so we roll 1d6. The roll is a 3 modified to a 9. And 9 is 3 over 6. So 3 additional step losses are inflicted on the Austrian force. And unfortunately for the Austrians, 3 steps is all that they have left. So the Austrian army of Germany is eliminated. And we place all eliminated Austrian units and leaders, including the army marker, in the Austrian reserve. Napoleon has no more movement points, but because he defeated a force in a zone that has an enemy fortress, he can now attack the fortress for free, that is, without having to expend a movement factor. So now we resolve siege combat against Salzburg. We roll 1d6. We add 3 for the differential of tactical values between Napoleon and Mack. Napoleon has a 3 as an offensive tactical value. And we add a plus 1 because he's commanding an army, and an army is understood to have a corps of engineers. So that's plus 4. For the duration of the siege, we do not add anything because this is the first siege attack against Salzburg. So we roll 1d6. The result is a 1 modified to a 5 stable. And stable means that there is no effect and the siege continues. So the siege in Salzburg will continue, and next time that Napoleon attacks, it will be with a plus 1 modifier for duration. And now we move to the coalition third round. The first thing we notice about the cards is that the highest activation number in any of these cards is a 3. But when we look at Charles' force, Charles activates with 2 activation points, as well as Kutuzov with 2. So there is no way that the coalition can activate both forces to move in this round. So the coalition has to choose between Charles's force or Kutuzov's. Kutuzov has only 4 strength points. He cannot afford to wait to Buxoden move here to join his force, because that would rob him of 1 movement factor. And he needs 6 movement factors to reach Vienna. With 5, he stays short here at Leopoldstadt. Plus, he would have to make an attrition die roll and use that modifier of traversing poor terrain. So that is going to be brutal. Charles, on the other hand, can lift the siege of Mantua. And with 5 movement points, he can reach Vienna. The downside is that Napoleon can intercept his force here at Carinthi. But that will have to be the risk that the Austrians will have to take. And I find it proper that they do the marching and the rush into Vienna. After all,
This is their country. So we will activate Charles's force. And to do so, we will play the permanent card for Austria for its activation value of 2.
So Charles announces that he will spend 2 additional movement points for force marching for a total of 5. And he intends to move here into Venice and continue his way until reaching Vienna. He moves his force into Venice, and this causes the siege of Mantua to be lifted. And now, when he's about to continue his movement, the French play this card for its event, Column of March. And the effect is that the activated coalition forces only move 1 area in this round. And that means that Charles has to stop right there. And that ends the coalition round here. We place the permanent Austrian card aside for next turn, if Austria survives. And the Column of March card was used for its event, which has a yellow star. So this card is permanently removed from the game. And this is the end of the coalition's 3rd round, and things cannot be better for the French right now. Now we move on to the French 4th round, and this is the last round of clear weather for 1805. Vienna seems ripe for the taking, but the situation is not an automatic Austrian surrender. The conditions for surrender are analyzed at the end of the turn, and we are 3 rounds away from that, so a lot can happen. Napoleon has to take Vienna, but first he must take Salzburg. Why? Because he wants to extend his supply line to Vienna, and a precondition for Austria's surrender is that Vienna be captured, but that the capturing force be in supply. So Napoleon has to take Salzburg first, then move and take Vienna. Marmont will attempt to move in this direction and end his move here in Moravia to stop the Russians from reaching the outskirts of Vienna. That means that Napoleon will have to fight with Charles. To do all that, the French need 3 activation points, and the French have 3 cards that provide 3 activation points. Fouché, Marie Walewska, and the permanent French card. We will play the Genius of Napoleon for its activation value of 3. The French will activate Napoleon's Grande Armée. The Grande Armée has a movement rating of 4, so the Grande Armée will force march an additional zone for a total of 5 movement factors. That will give the Grande Armée 2 shots at capturing Salzburg through siege, a 3rd movement point spent to move to Vienna, and 2 more attempts to take Vienna. It is important to take Salzburg, because then, with the remaining activation points, we will activate Marmont, who will move in this direction here to Moravia. And by setting his force here, he will be 2 zones away from Salzburg and will be in supply when he meets the Russians head on. So Napoleon announces that he will lay siege on Salzburg. I had forgotten to place a siege plus 1 marker over Salzburg on account of Napoleon's prior siege attack. Now the modifiers for this siege attempt are plus 3 for Napoleon's offensive tactical value, plus 1 because he's commanding an army and the army is supposed to have an inherent engineer corps, and plus 1 for the duration of the siege for a total of plus 5. We roll 1d6. The result is a 3 modified to an 8. Breach. A breach result means that the fortress surrenders, and if there would have been any Austrian troops there and leaders, they would have also surrendered. So we remove the siege marker, and by capturing the fortress, we place a destroyed fortress marker there, and we also place a French control marker on the zone. Now, there's a choice for Napoleon here. He can wait until the end of the turn, in which case the fortress will become usable as a supply conduit for the French who control the zone, or Napoleon can spend one of his mobile supply units to convert that fortress into friendly control and make it usable right now for supply purposes. And that's what he will do. He'll spend one of the mobile supply units, replace it in the French reserve, and that allows the French to convert the fortress of Salzburg for friendly use immediately and use it as a supply conduit. Now, Napoleon's Grande Armée has spent only one movement factor. So the second movement factor is spent to move into the zone surrounding Vienna, and the third movement factor is used to declare a siege attack on the fortress. So we place the siege marker, and the modifiers again are plus three for Napoleon's tactical rating and plus one for the inherent engineer corps in his army. That is a plus four. The die result is a six, modified to a 10. The result is a breach. The fortress surrenders, and if there would have been any troops inside the fortress, they would have been captured, but there's no troops here. So the fortress is destroyed, and we place another French control marker on the zone. So the French have captured Vienna. The Russians and Austrians have until the end of the turn to push the French back or cut the French supply line off. And the French supply line passes through Salzburg. Napoleon's army has two movement factors left, and Charles, to cut the supply line, he must move to this zone and then into this zone, Carinthy, and then move into Salzburg. So Napoleon will use his fourth movement factor to move south here into Carinthy to block the Austrians. And Napoleon detached Davout and two elite corps to leave them in the area surrounding Vienna. And that ends Napoleon's activation. He spent four of five movement points, even though he did not spend the fifth movement point, that is the one that causes the force march, he still has to roll on the attrition table. Now we have to roll for attrition for that force march, and the modifiers will be plus one for the movement point required, and because the force is composed exclusively of French, there is a minus one, so it is a total of minus one. So we roll one die, a six modified to a five, and the French lose one step. So we will reduce the 13 corps, which is a regular unit. And now the French Grande Armée has a total of seven combat factors. And the card that we just played, because it is the permanent card for France, does not go in the discard pile. We put it aside, and it will return in the next turn to the French hand. And now we move along to the fourth coalition round. So the coalition can have Charles move straight into Napoleon's zone and cause a battle there. Charles has seven combat factors, and Napoleon also has seven, but that's where the similarities end. Napoleon's tactical rating is far superior. The French would have cavalry superiority, and also the French have elite units that also provide a plus one modifier. In addition, Davout could conceivably countermarch and join Napoleon. The other alternative would be force marching Charles in this direction and expending six movement points to reach Vienna, but Napoleon can also intercept Charles in these three spaces. So the prospects for Charles outwitting Napoleon are slim to none. Let's take a look at what the Russians could do. The Russians could have Buxhauden join Kutuzov's army, and that would mean that the Russians would have eight strength points. And then Kutuzov could move in this direction and probably end here, if force marching two additional movement points, or here in Leopoldstadt, if force marching with three additional movement points. The coalition doesn't have any saved activation points. They could play one of their three activation point cards. Let's say they play this Admiralty card for the activation points and activate now either Charles or Kutuzov, which are activated with 2 points, saving 1 point for the next turn. And then in the next turn, they could play another 3 point card and add the activation point saved. That would allow them to move both Charles and Kutuzov's forces. So the coalition is going to play the Admiralty card for its activation value of 3. The coalition will spend 2 activation points to activate Kutuzov's army. All units in Kutuzov's army move at a rate of 3, so the army has 3 movement points. In this game, an army can spend 1 movement point to have an adjacent force join it. So Buxodin's force, which is here in Brest-Litovsk, will move to the zone where Kutuzov's army is. And because Buxodin has an inferior command or leadership rating, his hierarchy rating is 6, he can join Kutuzov's army as a subordinate commander. So we place now Buxodin with the Russian First Army, and he brings the Imperial Russian Guard and a regular infantry corps. Now the First Army has a total of 8 combat factors and 3 elite units. Having spent 1 of its 3 movement factors, now Kutuzov's army moves its remaining 2 movement factors to enter the zone surrounding Krakow. And Kutuzov ends his activation there. Why not force march for additional movement factors? Because if we force march Kutuzov and he moves along poor country, that will represent a +1 die roll modifier on the attrition table. The coalition has 1 activation point remaining, and it will save it for further use during this turn. Having used the Admiralty card for its activation value, it does not go in the regular discard pile. We place it aside, and it will come back into the coalition's hand next turn. And now we go to the 5th round. It will be the French 5th round, and we have bad weather. All units' movement allowances are reduced by 1. If the turn would end right now, the Austrians would be knocked out of the war. That is because its capital is in French hands and its main army was destroyed. So the burden of attack falls exclusively on the coalition. Knowing that, the French want to find a way to block the advance of this now powerful Russian army. And the way they're going to do it is by activating Marmont, who is in Bavaria. To do so, the French will play this card, Fouché, for its activation value of 3. Marmont is activated with 2 activation points. That means that the French will be able to save 1 activation point for use during the upcoming 6th and last round of this turn. Marmont's force moves at a rate of 2 movement factors because its slowest units, the Dutch and Bavarian Allied corps, have a movement allowance of 3, but because this is a bad weather turn, it is reduced to 2. So the French declare that Marmont's force will force march 2 additional movement points, and they will have to roll for attrition at the end of movement. Upon reaching Moravia, now we check for the attritional effect of this 2-zone force march. We notice that there is a +2 modifier for the number of zones force marched, but there is a -1 modifier because 50% or more of the force marching steps are French, so there it is a total of +1. The die roll on the 4-5 strength point column is a 3 modified to a 4, and the result is an asterisk, meaning that we have to roll 1d6 again, and upon a result of 4-6, the force loses 1 step. So we roll 1d6, and luckily for the French, they suffer no step losses. The French save their remaining activation point for use in the upcoming 6th round. And the Fouché card, used for its activation points, goes into the French discard pile. Now it's the coalition's 5th round, in bad weather. To try to create some sort of problem for the French, the coalition will activate Kutuzov's army, which will move towards Moravia to attack Marmont's force. And to do that, the coalition will play the Holy Russia card for its activation value. As we see here, there are units in Kutuzov's army that move 3 and 1 that moves 4. So the army moves at a rate of 3, but that is reduced by 1-2 because of the bad weather. Kutuzov will need two movement points just to reach Marmont's force and be able to attack it. So Kutuzov announces that he will force march an additional zone for a total of three movement points. First, the Russians spend two movement points to enter the zone in Moravia where Marmont's force is located, so we have a battle to resolve now. Marmont could attempt evasion, but he has no beneficial or positive die roll modifier that would give him a fighting chance, so he decides anyway to fight Kutuzov's army to weaken the Russian army before it reaches the gates of Vienna.
In this attack, four full-strength Russian units attack four half-strength French and French allied units. The Russians have eight combat factors. Marmont has four, so the Russians have a 2-to-1 advantage, so they start off with a plus one because of the odds ratio. Because Kutuzov has an offensive rating of one, that is also added, as well as Buxhowden's offensive rating of one as subordinate leader, so we're now at plus three. The morale of the Russian army is four because it's the majority of the unit's morale value. We select, or the Russians select, the first corps to lead the attack. And since it's an elite unit, it also adds a plus one. So the total die roll modifiers for the Russian army is plus four. For the French, a plus one for Marmont's defensive tactical value. The morale of the French side is five. Actually, we have the same number of units with different morale levels. So we can pick one morale level. We'll pick level five. And the French select the 5th Corps, which is already reduced to lead the assault. So that adds an additional plus one. So the French die roll modifier is plus two. This is a minor battle, so we use the middle column. There are not 22 combat factors in total, but there are more than seven. The Russians have a plus four modifier, so we roll 2d6. The result is a 7 modified to an 11, and the Russians cause two losses. Note that this is a 2+ result. The plus sign means that in the event that both sides inflict the same amount of losses, the side that inflicted the loss with the plus result is considered to be the winner. In the event that both sides obtain the same amount of losses and a plus result, then the defender is considered to be the winner. Now we roll for the French 2d6 with a plus 2 die roll modifier. The result is a 5 modified to a 7, and the French cause one loss. In this battle, the Russians, because they inflicted more losses, win. The French have to lose two steps. The first step has to be taken from the lead unit, which was the 5th Corps, and since it is already reduced, this unit is eliminated. The second step will be taken from the Dutch Corps, which is also reduced, so it is also eliminated. The Russians suffered one step loss, and it has to be taken from its lead unit, the 1st Corps, so it is flipped to its reduced side. Now we check to see if the French force is demoralized. The modified morale value is 5, which is the base morale value, plus one because of Marmont's tactical rating in defense, that's six, and minus one because of the differential in losses with the winner. So the morale is five, the modified morale. We roll one die, and unfortunately for the French, the die roll is higher than the modified morale, so Marmont's force is demoralized, and that means that the Russians can perform a cavalry pursuit. The only modifier in this cavalry pursuit is Kutuzov's tactical rating. It serves as a plus one, so we roll 1d6. The roll is a 4 modified to a 5, and the final die roll after modification is not higher than 6, so the French suffer no additional losses as a result of the cavalry pursuit. And we rolled a 3 for Buxhowden, so he is not wounded. The eliminated French and Dutch forces go into the French reserve. And now Marmont's demoralized force has to retreat, and it will do so to the zone immediately to the southwest. Kutuzov has one movement point remaining as a result of the force march, so he will move to the zone surrounding Leopoldstadt.
And that is the end of Kutuzov's activation, and he is currently adjacent to Vienna. Now we resolve attrition for Kutuzov's army that force marched one extra zone. And the modifiers are plus one for the zone force marched, plus two because it is a winter round, but minus one because the force is composed exclusively of Russians, for a total of plus two. We roll 1d6. The roll is a 1 modified to a 3, and the result is an asterisk. So we roll an additional die roll, and on a roll of 4 to 6, Kutuzov's army will lose one step. So we roll 1d6. The result is a 2, so Kutuzov's army does not lose any strength. The Holy Russia card is placed aside, and it will form part of the coalition's hand for the next turn. And now we go to the French sixth round, and this is a winter round. In a winter round, all movement allowances are still reduced by one, and there is an additional plus two die roll modifier to attrition die rolls during force marches. The French have these three cards remaining, and they would probably like to use this card for the event during the diplomacy phase, and that would be the diplomacy phase of the 1807 turn. And this is a combat card that could be used in any upcoming combat in this round. So the French will not play any card, but they will execute a one activation point round, and that activation point will be used to activate Napoleon. Napoleon will not force march during this winter round, so his army has three movement factors. Napoleon spends his first movement factor to move into the zone around Vienna, and his second movement factor to cross the bridge into the zone around Leopoldstadt. And now he engages the Russian army in combat. In this French attack, Napoleon has seven combat factors, and the Russians have an equal number. The die roll modifiers for the French are as follows: plus three for Napoleon's offensive tactical value, plus one for his subordinate Murat's offensive tactical value. The French clearly have cavalry superiority. That gives another plus one. We're right now at plus five. The morale of the French army is five, and the 4th Corps is chosen to lead the assault. It is an elite unit. It adds another plus one for a total of plus six. But because the French army crossed the river to attack Kutuzov, there is a minus one. So the total die roll modifier for the French is plus five. The Russians have a plus two for Kutuzov's defensive tactical value. Buxhowden adds nothing on defense. There is a plus one because the 2nd Russian Corps is leading the assault, and it is an elite unit. And Russian morale is at level four. So the total die roll modifier for the Russian army is plus three. The French now play this card, Tirailleurs, for its event, and it reduces the die roll modifier for the Russians to plus two. The French roll 2d6. They roll a 6 modified to an 11. They cause two step losses, and the result has a plus sign. The Russians roll an 8 modified to a 10, and they cause two step losses, but their result does not have a plus sign. So in this case, we have both sides inflicting two losses on the enemy side, but the French have the plus sign in their result, so the French win the battle. The Russians eliminate their first step from their lead unit, the 4th Corps, which is flipped to its inverted side. And the Russians fulfilled the second step loss by flipping the 2nd Corps to its reduced side. The French fulfilled their first step loss by flipping the lead unit, the 4th Corps, to its reduced side. And the second step is satisfied by eliminating the reduced 13th Corps. Now we roll 1d6 to determine if Murat, the subordinate French leader, is wounded. And that only happens on a roll of 6. The result is a 2, so Murat is unaffected. Now we determine if the Russians are demoralized. We're going to roll one die and see if it is higher than the modified morale value. The morale value starts at 4, which was the original morale value for the Russian army, and we add the tactical value of Kutuzov on defense, plus 2, that gives us a 6. And then we add the differential in losses with the winner. In this case, the losses were equal, so that does not affect this calculation, but we have to subtract 1 because of the Tirolier's combat card. So the modified Russian morale is 5. Only a die roll of 6 will demoralize the Russian army. So we roll 1d6. The result is a 6, and the Russian army is demoralized. We placed this black flag on Kutuzov's army, and now the French conduct a cavalry pursuit. We solve the cavalry pursuit by rolling 1 die and adding the tactical value of the commanding general, that would be plus 3. Plus 1, because there is a cavalry general here, and plus 1 for each step of reserve cavalry. So we have a plus 6, and we roll 1d6, and any result above 6 is the number of additional step losses inflicted on the Russian army. So we roll 1d6. Luckily for the Russians, the French roll a 1, which is modified to a 7, and 7 is 1 greater than 6, so the Russians only lose 1 step on account of the cavalry pursuit, and the Russians decide to eliminate the 4th Corps to satisfy that step loss. And that is the end of this combat. And Murat is not wounded. Now Kutuzov must retreat. If he retreats through this mountain without a pass, he suffers another step, so he will retreat into Moravia. The eliminated Russian corps is placed in the Russian reserve. And the Tirailleurs card, used for its event and having a yellow star, is removed permanently from the game. The French had saved 1 activation point, which if they don't use at this time, which is the last round, they'll lose it. So they'll have to lose it. And that ends the French activations for round 6. And now it is the last round for the coalition, round 6, winter round. The only coalition force that is not demoralized that can conceivably reach Vienna in this round is Charles' force. So the coalition will play this card, National Pride, for its activation value of 2 to activate Charles. Charles's force moves at a rate of 2 movement factors on account of the winter weather. In order to reach Vienna, Charles needs 4 movement factors. That means he'll have to force march 2 additional movement factors, and he announces that he will do that. So Charles's force moves all the way into the zone surrounding Vienna to engage Davout. Davout has 2 French corps. Now Napoleon has a chance to intercept Charles' force and also join the battle around Vienna. Before solving the battle, Charles has to roll for the attrition as a result of the force march. The modifiers are plus 2 for the 2 zones force marched, plus 2 because it is winter, but minus 2 because the movement was across national territory. So it's a modified plus 2 die roll. And the result is a 2 modified to a 4, and that is an asterisk. An asterisk means that another die roll is made, and on a roll of 4 to 6, the force loses 1 step. So 1d6 is rolled. The roll is a 3, so Charles's force loses no steps. To be able to intercept, the intercepting general must play a card with a value which is equal or greater than the initiative of the general. Napoleon has an initiative of 1, so the French will play the cavalry of the guard that has an activation value of 2 in order to allow him to attempt to intercept Charles's force. To successfully intercept, Napoleon has to roll a final die roll of 5 or more. So the die roll modifiers here are plus 1 because the French have cavalry superiority, and a plus 1 because Napoleon's initiative is lower than Charles. So it is a plus 2. So we roll 1d6. The result is a 2 modified to a 4. And Napoleon fails to intercept Charles's force. So it will be Charles against Davout. Let's take a look at the forces here. This is a minor battle. Charles has 7 combat factors. Davout has 4. So it's a 1-to-1 attack. Charles has a +1 for his offensive tactical value. And there are no more modifiers for the Austrians. The Austrian morale is 3. The French have a +3 for Davout's defensive tactical value. Their morale is 5, and the French select the 3rd Corps to lead the assault. It is an elite unit. It adds another +1, so the French have a total die roll modifier of +4. The Austrians roll 2d6, 7 modified to an 8. It is a 1 plus result, so the French will lose 1 step. The French roll a 5 modified to a 9, and they cause 2 step losses on the Austrians, so the French win this battle. The 2 Austrian step losses will be fulfilled by reducing the 4th and 5th Austrian corps. The French step loss is satisfied by reducing the lead unit, the 3rd Corps, to its reduced side. Now we determine if the Austrians are demoralized. The base morale is 3. We add 1 for Charles' tactical value, that is 4, and we add the differential in losses. In this case, the Austrians have a -1 in differential, so it drops the modified morale to 3. Any roll above 3 means that the Austrians are demoralized. The die roll is a 5, which is higher than the modified morale, so the Austrians are demoralized, and we place a black flag on Charles's force. Now the French will execute a cavalry pursuit. To solve the cavalry pursuit, we will add to a die roll the tactical value of Davout on defense, +3. There is no cavalry general nor reserve cavalry, so that will be the only die roll modifier, +3, and any result above 6 is the number of additional step losses suffered by the Austrians. So we roll 1d6. The roll is a 5 modified to an 8, and 8 is 2 greater than 6, so the Austrians suffer 2 more step losses. They will reduce the 6th Corps and eliminate the already reduced 7th Corps. And that's the end of the combat, and now the Austrians must retreat. And the Austrians retreat 1 zone to the south of Vienna. Each side had saved 1 activation point. The turn is now over, and activation points are not carried over to the next turn, so they are lost. And that ends the coalition's round, round number 6, and that is the end of the activations phase. We now proceed to the conquest phase, and there are consequences that are enforced now as a result of the conquest of Austria. The defeat of Austria represents an extra card for France in the next turn, so we mark it accordingly. Another consequence is that the continental blockade is imposed on the Austrian ports of Venice, Trieste, or Sara, independently of whether the continental blockade card has been played. Now Austria loses 3 provinces that can be annexed to France or any of its minor allies. The first province is going to be the province of Venice, which is now annexed to the Kingdom of Italy, and together with Roman and Milan, now the Kingdom of Italy has expanded, and as a result of that, a second Italian corps is now available and placed in the French reserves. France also annexes the province of Tyrol, and by special rule now, the Kingdom of Bavaria is formed, and it is a minor ally of France. The creation of the Kingdom of Bavaria provides 1 additional card for the French. This concludes the 1805 turn. We will continue in the next video with 1806, starting with the interphase, and we will go into some detail because it's the first time we encounter the interface. After that, we will go through the activation phase in a more expedited way. So stay tuned for the next turn in Napoleon Against Europe, 1806, coming up next.